Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ash Carter.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone, and thanks for being here. And look at those magnificent service members standing so proud. Thank you. Listen, before I begin, I need to share with you, in case you weren't aware, that it's been a tough day for us in Afghanistan. Two of our service members were killed, along with four others wounded, in an operation alongside our Afghan partners in Kunduz province. The Afghans also suffered casualties. We're still learning all the details, but I hope you'll join me in expressing our deepest condolences to the family, loved ones, friends, and teammates of those affected by this tragedy. All of them are in our thoughts and prayers. And we're going to honor their sacrifice by remaining firm in our resolve to complete our mission in Afghanistan. Over 40 years ago, a young high school student in Washington, D.C. got a summer job working at the Navy Department's Naval Sea Systems Command. Now, for those who may not be old enough to remember, I am, that was a different time for our military. I remember it all too well. This was the last years of Vietnam. Our armed forces were facing many challenges. It was also the start of a technological revolution that transformed how we live, how we work, and how we fight. And just to show you, in a summer intern in those days in Washington, D.C. worked the punch card machine, because that was how computers worked back then. Now, four decades later, our technology, our military, and that young man have come a long way. You can see that remarkable progress in how our military operates and where we operate, from space to cyberspace. You can see it in how this command, the United States Strategic Command, supports every DoD mission in every region and in every domain. And you can also see that progress in the leader we honor today, Admiral Cecil Haney, once that key operator, key punch operator, and now, combatant commander, and long an inspiration to our men and women in uniform. Chairman Dunford, Stratcom team, Congressman Ashford, Congressman Fortenberry, Mayor Ritas, friends, family, it's an honor to be with you today as we pass this critical command from Admiral Haney to General John Hyten, two of our military's most accomplished leaders. I'd like to especially welcome Admiral Haney's family, his wife, whom he affectionately calls Ms. Bonnie, daughter Elizabeth. Although Cecil may be the warrior in the family, we know Bonnie's the real fighter. Bonnie, we owe you a tremendous debt of gratitude for your service and your sacrifice over the years. I know you're looking forward to spending more time with your husband and all of us in the DoD family, including me, my wife Stephanie. Wish you and your family the very best. And to the men and women of Stratcom, each and every one of you, all of you, are doing one of the noblest things a person can do, which is to help defend our magnificent country and to make a better life and a better world for our children. In the heart of our nation, you perform a mission at the center of everything we do as a department. You underpin our nuclear deterrence. You enable precision-guided munitions and navigation, space capabilities, and experiment with new warfighting strategies in emerging domains to prepare us for whatever the future may bring. Through it all, each of you is critical at a time when our military is addressing five major, unique, and rapidly evolving challenges. We're countering the prospect of Russian aggression and coercion, especially in Europe. We're managing historic change in the Asia Pacific, the single most consequential region of the world for America's future. We're strengthening our deterrent and defense forces in the face of North Korea's continued nuclear and missile provocations. We're checking Iranian aggression and malign influence in the Gulf and protecting our friends and allies in the Middle East. We're accelerating the lasting defeat of ISIL, lasting and certain defeat, destroying it and its parent tumor in Iraq and Syria, and everywhere else it metastasizes around the world, even as we help protect our homeland and our people. And we're preparing to contend, moreover, with an uncertain future, ensuring that we continue to be ready for challenges we may not even anticipate today. And all the while, of course, America's nuclear deterrence remains the bedrock of our security, which all of you ensure here at Stratcom. As you do so, you manage uncertainty, prepare for change, and perform your duties with the unparalleled excellence we expect of each and every one of you. I couldn't be prouder of what you've accomplished. And you've done all this thanks to the wisdom and leadership of Admiral Haney. For Cecil, of course, that summer job became a remarkable career. Graduating from Annapolis in 1978, he joined the Navy at a time when we were still very much thinking about the Cold War and that kind of threat. And much has changed since then, but over the years, whether he was commanding a submarine, operationalizing our rebalance to the Asia Pacific as commander of the Pacific Fleet, or addressing global multi-domain threats here in Nebraska, Cecil has confronted many of our most complex challenges with unwavering dedication, profound insight, and the calm, deliberative manner that the gravity of these missions requires. Although most of Cecil's accomplishments remain classified, of course, I want to highlight some that he's done to strengthen our systems, our partnerships, and our people. As a strategist, Admiral Haney contributed to the essential missions of today, even as he prepared Stratcom for the missions of tomorrow, by ensuring a safe, secure, and effective nuclear deterrent force, while paving the way to its future, and by collaborating in new and innovative ways with our intelligence community on space issues. As an ambassador in uniform, he built bridges to our allies, to academia, to industry, recognizing, as he says, that there's no stronger deterrent message than partnerships and international cooperation. That message is powerful because, as all of you know, the United States is an unrivaled source of innovation in DoD and outside of DoD. And the United States also has an unrivaled network of friends and allies around the world, and our potential opponents have none. That's not accidental. And as a leader here at Stratcom, he's been a champion for your mission and, most importantly, for his people, all of you. That was particularly important as DoD undertook and implemented the 2014 Nuclear Enterprise Reviews, which recognized that our country had for decades underinvested in its nuclear forces, and not only in its aging technologies, but also in its people. And we're determined to correct that now, and we're just beginning to do so. More on that in a moment. And that's in part because Cecil worked tirelessly to get you and your families the resources you need, the opportunities to advance your career, and the climate to empower your success. Through all this, Admiral Haney leaves Stratcom, DoD, and our country stronger because he planned for the future, strengthened key partnerships, and helped ensure we invested in our capabilities, our people, uniformed and civilian. For all that, I'm confident that Stratcom will be ready no matter what tomorrow brings. And I'm certain the nation owes a debt of gratitude to Cecil, to Bonnie, and the rest of the Haney family. Thank you all. Now, as we honor Stratcom's commander this morning, I also want to talk to you about your nuclear and space missions and emphasize how important they are to our department, our military, and our nation. In September, I visited Minot Air Base in North Dakota, home of some of the ICBMs and bombers under this command. And I made clear that America's nuclear deterrent is the bedrock of our security. While this mission isn't in the headlines every day, as I see it, we're in real trouble if it ever is. It remains the highest priority of the Department of Defense. That means it's one of Stratcom's most important jobs, ones that we count on you every day to perform with unparalleled excellence, excellence you define. That's because you deter large-scale nuclear attacks against the United States and our allies. You help convince potential adversaries they can't escalate their way out of a failed conventional aggression. You assure our allies that our extended deterrent guarantees are credible. And if deterrence fails, though we hope it never does, you provide the President with options to achieve American and allied objectives, all to reduce the risk of nuclear weapons ever being used in the first place. And as you execute these missions, I and DOD's other senior leaders are making sure we sustain our deterrent by recapitalizing all three legs of our nuclear triad so they don't age into obsolescence. Indeed, even as we would all, of course, wish to live in a world without nuclear weapons, it's also true, something President Obama has noted many times, that we may not realize that goal in our lifetimes. And so we must continue to maintain a safe, secure, an effective nuclear deterrent. As I mentioned earlier, we're beginning to correct for decades of underinvestment in nuclear deterrence. Dating back to the end of the Cold War, when the United States believed it would be safe to allow funding for the nuclear enterprise to drop. And drop it did, dramatically. Over the last 25 years, we made only modest investments in basic sustainment and operations. But while we didn't build anything new for 25 years, and neither did our allies, others did, including Russia, North Korea, China, Pakistan, India, and for a period of time, Iran. So we can't wait any longer, and we also can't operate under the mistaken assumption that our own recapitalization will stimulate others to invest, because the evidence is just the opposite. They have consistently invested in nuclear weapons during a quarter-century pause in U.S. investment. Our recapitalization is about sustaining deterrence in a world very different from the world of the Cold War. From ballistic missile submarines to ICBMs, from bombers to air-launched cruise missiles, we're replacing many aging nuclear weapons delivery systems, because if we don't, we'll lose them, which would mean losing confidence in our ability to deter, something we can never afford. Our necessary replacements include the long-range standoff weapon, replacing nuclear air-launched cruise missiles that enable the penetration of air defenses by our air-launched deterrent. Exactly, precisely, just the same logic as when they were first deployed four decades ago. Our necessary replacements also include our Ohio replacement program to build the next generation of ballistic missile submarines. Our necessary replacements also include the ground-based strategic deterrent program, in which we'll be replacing old ICBMs with new ones that will be less expensive to maintain. And they include investments in the nuclear command and control, communications, and intelligence capabilities that support our nuclear enterprise. As many of you know, that includes satellites, radar systems, ground stations, command posts, control nodes, communications links, and more, which are critical to assuring nuclear command and control and providing us with integrated tactical warning and attack assessment. And we're investing in many more parts of our nuclear enterprise as well. We're continuing to make vital investments in the people of our nuclear force, the men and women who operate, enable, maintain, and secure America's nuclear deterrent every day. We continue to support the Department of Energy and its national laboratories that play a critical role as DOD's partners in the nuclear deterrent mission. And we're making much-needed infrastructure and facilities repairs to ensure the maintenance and security of the DOD bases and installations that are home to the nuclear enterprise are up to date. This enterprise relies heavily on our space systems. But nuclear deterrence is far from being the only mission we have that depends on space. And let me turn to that, a second mission of Stratcom. Not everyone thinks about it, but the truth is, space is woven into every aspect of our military operations today, conventional and nuclear alike. And that's why we're making sure and making it known that our space capabilities are as resilient and assured as our nuclear capabilities. Well, in the past, we may have been able to view space as a virtual sanctuary. DoD must now prepare for competition there and seek to prevent conflict from extending into space. Thanks in part to Admiral Haney's leadership and the hard work of Stratcom personnel, we're doing just that, working closely with our partners in the intelligence community and with our allies. Indeed, as space becomes increasingly congested and contested and competitive, it makes Stratcom's work to deter and defend against attacks in space all the more important. That's why we're continuing to make serious investments in capabilities that enhance our ability to identify, attribute, and negate threatening actions by others in space. Our new investments aim to foil these efforts, whether an adversary aims to blind our reconnaissance satellites with lasers, disrupt our satellite communications with jammers, or use kinetic means like a co-orbital ASAT or a direct descent to ASAT to destroy the space capabilities that support our forces. Now, some have suggested we should treat space as something separate, either organizationally or managerially or operationally, but doing so would be a mistake because every one of our missions in every domain, air, land, sea, and cyber, and also our potential opponents, rely on space in some way. Because of that, we must integrate and not separate everything we have and do in space. All of you, the men and women of Stratcom, are ensuring that we leverage and integrate the advantages we enjoy in space for the great benefit of all our combatant commanders and forces on the ground and in the air and in the sea. Stratcom is helping us write a playbook for future space operations to follow by incorporating space into our operations and our contingency planning. Indeed, as we've been updating each of our core contingency plans at DoD, we've made sure they account for how we must now view space as a potential warfighting domain. To make sure we're doing so effectively, we need to experiment. And that's where Stratcom's Joint Interagency Combined Space Operations Center, JICSPOC, comes in. I created the JICSPOC last year to experiment with new concepts of integrated space operations, and so far it's been very effective, helping us identify ways to improve data sharing, hone our ability to protect and defend critical space infrastructure, and assure command and control if they come under attack. And for several years now, General John Hyten has played a key role in how we've begun to treat space as a warfighting domain. He's been a key partner of mine from when we first saw the need for what would become JICSPOC all the way through how we've operationalized that vision. And that's one of the many reasons why I'm pleased that he's bringing his 35 years of experience to Stratcom as its next commander. Of course, he's also bringing along his wonderful family, namely wife Laura. Hi, Laura. She's here this morning, along with her children, Katie and Chris, and John's brother, Scott, and proud parents, Sherwin and Barbara, who are with us too. Thank you all for being here. This is John and Laura's 15th move since John joined the Air Force. So as he assumes this critical command for our country, I want to thank his family for their flexibility, for their service, and their support. Thanks, Laura and family. Today, John's returning to Offutt after leading our Air Force Space Command in Colorado. There, he organized, trained, and equipped over 30,000 men and women to support Stratcom's missions. But just as important, he's helped shape thinking at our government's highest levels about the threats we face in space. And I've certainly benefited from his strategic counsel. I've known John for years. We worked together closely when his Air Force's Director of Space Acquisition at the Pentagon, I was Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition Technology and Logistics. I can't publicly describe everything we worked on together, but I can say with great confidence that throughout his career, whether serving in space operations, acquisition roles, and all the other things he's done, John has developed a keen understanding of the current and future operational needs of our DoD Space Force and how to acquire the capabilities we need. His experience and expertise will be a tremendous asset to Stratcom as we prepare to face future threats in all domains. And John also has a keen appreciation for what's at stake across the entire strategic landscape, for which I will depend on him, and as will the President. When he's in D.C., he's been known to road trip up to Gettysburg to study that 150-year-old battle, and recognizing that, well, the lush hills of Gettysburg couldn't be more different from the endless vacuum of space. A kinetic conflict in space could exact an even higher toll than that bloody battle and leave behind a legacy that would last far longer. John's determined not to let that happen. And whether it's by building interagency partnerships through JCSPOC, training our men and women to face new challenges, John's helped build a more resilient national security space enterprise that'll also help strengthen our nuclear deterrent. That's important work he'll continue here at Stratcom, because there's more to be done to confront those 21st century threats. We have to continuously adapt, innovate, and stay flexible. With his demonstrated leadership, expertise, managerial acumen, strategic vision, John will be a strong leader for this command for years to come, ensuring it meets not only the challenges we face today, but also those we'll confront in the future. I'll close by emphasizing again that we really have come a long way, both as a military and a country, from that summer over 40 years ago when Cecil worked that punch card machine. Today, ours is the finest fighting force the world has ever known. There's no other military that's stronger, more capable, more experienced, or more innovative in every domain. That's why our military edge is second to none, and it's a fact every American ought to be proud of. That edge and all that progress is the result of each of our leaders, each of our officers, each of our enlisted service members, and each of you, every soldier, sailor, airman, Marine, and DoD civilian, being dedicated to leaving their unit, their command, their office, and their mission a whole lot better, stronger, and more advanced than when they got there. It's an iterative process, one we all contribute to, one I'm very proud of. That's exactly what Admiral Haney did here at Stratcom, left his mission a whole lot stronger. Cecil, we're grateful for your tremendous contributions to our safety, to our strategy, and our deterrence. And most of all, we're grateful for everything you and Bonnie have done over the years for our people, here in Nebraska and everywhere you've served. As you transition from this command, you can take comfort in knowing that Stratcom is now in the hands of another proven strategic leader who will keep pushing forward. In the days to come, Stratcom's mission will continue to remain vitally important to the bedrock of our security. And General Hyten will lead this critical team with the full trust and confidence of me, Chairman Dunford, and President Obama. And the force he inherits is ready to execute any mission required, thanks to Admiral Haney's visionary leadership. So to Admiral Haney and Bonnie, to General Hyten and Laura, to their families, to all the men and women who have served under their strong and steady leadership, thank you for everything you've done to meet the challenges of today, to stay ahead of the threats of tomorrow, and to keep our nation safe. May God bless you, and may God bless our magnificent country. Thank you. Me at the center of the stage.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise while the Secretary of Defense presents the Defense Distinguished Service Medal to Admiral Cecil D. Haney. Citation to accompany the award of the Defense Distinguished Service Medal. Admiral Cecil D. Haney, United States Navy, distinguished himself by exceptionally distinguished service as Commander, United States Strategic Command, from November 2013 to December 2016. During this period, Admiral Haney's profound insight, visionary leadership, and operational expertise ensured the command excelled in its vital national role as a functional global warfighting command. Admiral Haney flawlessly executed the command's global missions of strategic deterrence and assurance, space and cyberspace operations, as well as the key joint enablers of information operations, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, combating weapons of mass destruction, and integrated missile defense. He revectored the command's perspective by addressing the emergence of a hybrid, multi-capable, and multi-dimensional threat by establishing clear priorities and near-term objectives to address present and future challenges in the modern security environment. The distinctive accomplishments of Admiral Haney culminate a long and distinguished career in the service of his country and reflect great credit upon himself, the United States Navy, and the Department of Defense. Thank you, Mr. Secretary and Admiral Haney. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph Dunford, United States Marine Corps.
Elected officials, community leaders, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and most of all, to the men and women of the United States Strategic Command, it's an honor to join Secretary Carter today as we mark the transfer of command authority between Admiral Haney and General Hyten. The change of command ceremony, as the narrator mentioned, is a time-honored military custom that ensures a seamless transition of authority and responsibility. In effect, I like to say the changes of command are actually more about continuity than they are about change. Tomorrow morning, just like this morning, the men and women of Stratcom will wake up with complete focus and commitment to the mission and complete trust in their leadership. But changes of command are also an opportunity to take stock of the command. And I'd like to begin by briefly talking about the men and women of the command. Day in and day out, the soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines of the Strategic Command protect our nation against strategic attacks. They prepare to defeat those who would attack us if deterrence fails, and they ensure that the joint force has assured access to space and cyberspace. The Secretary mentioned it, and it's not an overstatement to say that they perform the most important missions in the Department of Defense. Over the past several months, I've had the opportunity and the privilege to see some of the men and women of the Strategic Command in action. I visited the Joint Interagency Combined Space Operations Center, and I saw innovative airmen as part of a joint team experimenting to ensure that our nation maintains a competitive advantage in space. I visited the USS Alaska and met sailors who spend months at a time undersea, delivering our nation's reliable and survivable sea-based nuclear deterrent. I visited Cyber Command and met with a joint team developing cutting-edge tools to take the fight to the Islamic State in cyberspace. And just yesterday, I witnessed the commitment and the competence of the 5th Bomb Wing and the 91st Missile Wing. Those are airmen who stand watch 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and proudly deliver two legs of nuclear triad. From my visits, I've gained an appreciation for the men and women of Strategic Command in the breadth and the complexity of their missions. As Admiral Haney often says, the command's mission starts deep under the sea and extends to geosynchronous orbit. So I want to join Secretary Carter in talking to the men and women of this superb team and just let you know that your contributions, the unique mission that you perform, the contribution you make to our nation is both recognized and appreciated. You're the reason why the American people are safe from nuclear attack. You're the reason our allies are assured. You're the reason that our adversaries are deterred. And you're the reason that senior leaders across the department are so confident and proud in you. For the last 3 years, the performance of the Strategic Command has reflected the visionary leadership of Admiral Cecil Haney. His service at the helm of Stratcom is the culmination of a career spanning nearly 40 years. Cecil's a man of great faith. He's a humble servant, and he epitomizes the term warrior scholar. He's led at every level, from the division to the Pacific Fleet to a combatant command. He served on 5 different submarines in both the Atlantic and the Pacific fleets. And he's done the hard staff jobs both in the operating forces and in the Pentagon. Through it all, he's made a lasting impact, improving every organization that he's been a part of and shaping the future of our strategic forces. But most importantly, as a trainer, a mentor, and a role model, Cecil Haney has inspired a legion of men and women who are always going to be proud to say that they're Haney trained. You know, you can't talk to Cecil for more than 5 minutes without him sharing that he wouldn't be the leader that he is without the incredible support that he has at home. And that, of course, starts with his wife, Bonnie. And Bonnie, you've been there every step of the way for the past 38 years. In that time, you've moved 20 times, and you've been literally separated from Cecil for years. You've raised 3 great children, and you've been a friend and a supporter of countless military spouses and families. And on behalf of all that you've touched along the way, I just want to say on behalf of Ellen and I how much we appreciate what you've done, what a difference you've made, and how much we recognize the sacrifice that you made as well. And we recognized you once before, and I'm just going to ask the crowd to please help me in recognizing you one more time. Although the Haney sons, Thomas and Joseph, weren't able to make it today, Elizabeth is over there in the front row. And Elizabeth, thanks to you and your brothers for sharing your dad. In the coming weeks, we're going to honor Admiral Haney's 4 decades of service to the nation. But for now, Cecil and Bonnie, please know that as you prepare to go over the side, you do so with the admiration, the appreciation, and the affection of all with whom you've served. And that certainly includes Joe and Ellen Dunford. Ladies and gentlemen, when it came time for President Obama and Secretary Carter to select Cecil's replacement, I bore witness to a very brief conversation and an apparently very easy decision. Given the array of threats and challenges we faced, they knew that leading an organization of Strategic Command's importance was going to require a special leader. And clearly, we have that kind of leader in General John Hyten. In 35 years of service, John has commanded at the squadron, group, wing, and major command levels. He's been a space mission director, and he deployed forward to oversee the Joint Forces space requirements during the height of operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. General Hyten is also a visionary leader who developed the Department of Defense's first ever concept for space operations. He returns to Offutt with precisely the kind of experience, competence, and proven leadership that Stratcom's unique mission requires. And to John's wife, Laura, welcome back to you as well, and thanks for your sacrifice and support and your agreement to make, yes, yet another PCS move. And good luck on Veterans Day when your household effects are delivered and everybody else is enjoying a long weekend. And to Katie and Chris, thanks for sharing John with us for a few more years. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to be with you to thank Admiral Haney for his leadership and distinguished service and to mark the transfer of authority to General Hyten. And at this time, I have the privilege of inviting Admiral Haney to join me at center stage as we recognize the men and women of Strategic Command and the extraordinary contribution they make to our nation's security. Cecil.
Thank you, General Dunford. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise while General Dunford presents the Joint Meritorious Unit Award to United States Strategic Command. Headquarters, United States Strategic Command, and its components distinguished themselves by exceptionally meritorious service from 16 November 2013 to 3 November 2016. During this period, the command was instrumental in shaping key national security policies and providing warfighting solutions across the spectrum of operations. The command transformed the responsiveness and flexibility of the Strategic Deterrence Forces' operational plans and capabilities through the approval and implementation of the Family of Plans. The command championed the first ever holistic Department of Defense adversary problem set seminar that leveraged key agencies across the whole of government to forge unique solutions to address the complex global security environment. To reinforce the safety, security, and effectiveness of the nation's nuclear deterrent forces, the command supported numerous multilateral events across the globe, to include the first overseas ballistic missile submarine port visit in 12 years. Additionally, through the effective use of strategic bombers and space and cyberspace operations, the command played an integral role in providing key capabilities to the comprehensive strategy to degrade and defeat the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. In response to the President's call to accelerate the campaign, the command established a cyber mission force in direct support of the operational combatant commander to counter emerging cyber threats. Furthermore, United States Strategic Command refined the joint targeting enterprise by integrating and synchronizing space, cyber, electronic warfare, and nuclear deterrent capabilities with Geographic Combatant Command's plans and processes during global operations. Finally, the command established operational multi-agency forums to strengthen the nation's space enterprise resilience to adapt to an increasingly contested, degraded, and operationally limited space domain and protect the nation's critical space assets. The establishment of its Space Defense Operations Center leveraged unity of effort between interagency and intelligence community partners to increase space collaboration and coordination between defense and intelligence communities and protect and defend critical space capabilities. By their exemplary performance of duty, the members of Headquarters, United States Strategic Command, have brought great credit to themselves and the Department of Defense. Thank you, General Dunford. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. I present to you Admiral Cecil D. Haney, Commander, United States Strategic Command.
Well, good morning. And I think I ought to start off by saying congratulations, Chicago Cubs fans. I hope you weren't up too late last night. Well, Secretary Carter, boss, I can't thank you enough for being here today, just knowing how busy you are. I salute your leadership, your support, your relentless drive and energy in support of our nation's defense, in addressing the threats, as he mentioned, facing our nation now and for the foreseeable future. You have appropriately demanded that we aggressively address the threats facing our nation with all our capabilities and challenged our thinking. You have focused us on innovation in approaches, concepts, technology, and our workforce. Thank you and President Obama for trusting me as a leader in this very exciting assignment. Chairman Dunford, I thank you for visiting our strategic forces in Minot just yesterday. Your strategic force focus on the challenges facing our nation, your leadership, and of course, your friendship. Ellen, I thank you also for being here and all the spouses you represent and that have also sacrificed through our military history. The recognition that you, both Secretary and Chairman, have provided this command and me. Personally, I would argue it's less about me, but about the wonderful team of sailors, soldiers, airmen, and Marines, and civilians that make up U.S. Strategic Command. From the most junior amongst the team to my senior leadership team, you have all made a difference. I and this grateful nation will remain indebted to you for your stellar service, and also deeply appreciate all the support your families have provided. Please thank them for me. Congratulations, team. You have so much to be proud of. And while we have made progress, as discussed by the Secretary and the Chairman, we all know we have much more to accomplish. I know under the leadership of my good friend, General John Hyten, you will continue moving forward with mission excellence in such areas as deterrence and assurance, space, cyber, missile defense, and electronic warfare. So how does this all get accomplished? It's about teamwork from a very disciplined, motivated group of professionals who have had a common goal of delivering strategic stability and warfighting solutions. It requires top leadership support and, of course, resources. It requires relentless focus and perseverance. It requires a team that values process improvement and professional development. It requires a team that promotes partnership with the Department of Defense, the interagency, our allies and partners, and partnerships with others, including industry and academia. It requires a team that looks to develop a deep, deep, deep understanding of the strategic environment and associated adversaries, to understand and challenges the status quo, while also looks hard to develop innovative solutions in warfighting and deterrence. That's what I experienced here at U.S. Strategic Command, a team that has been particularly focused on getting it done. You, to a person, I think, know just how proud I am of you. Yes, qualities represented by the team of professionals standing before you in the formation under the leadership of my Chief of Staff, Major General Jim Dickinson. It's intellectuals such as those that made up the group that sang our national anthem today, Command Performance, and the Color Guard, all of which also have other duties and responsibilities in my headquarters. It's people like the deputies I have had, currently Vice Admiral Chaz Richards and his predecessors, Jim Kowalski and Sebby Wilson, or my command chief, Pat McMahon, or his predecessor, Chief Master Sergeant Pat Alston. It is the flag officers, the general officers, the senior executive service members, the senior enlisted advisors at the headquarters, and at my components and the task force that lead our strategic command team most days without any fanfare all over the globe. All part of our all-volunteer force that is on watch from under the sea in submarines, under the ground in intercontinental ballistic missile launch control centers, in bomber cockpits, or in operations centers controlling our space capabilities in geosynchronous orbit, or in planning cells in direct support of our missions, or in support of other combatant commands, and all in between, supported by remarkable families and a vibrant, patriotic, and caring community. Guys like Air Force Colonel Jeff Hoken, who just returned from a 6-month deployment in the Middle East, ensuring the commander of the Joint Task Force Operation Inherent Resolve was fully supported with our warfighting capabilities integrated into the counter ISIL campaign. Having seen his work firsthand, I can attest to the work he has done. Or Navy Captain retired Steve Pettit, who has led an elite team in an elaborate effort to upgrade our operational plans. Even at a time of people reductions and efficiencies, the passion, the energy of the people, from those working in our National Department of Energy laboratories to those flying those 40-plus hour missions in the confines of bomber cockpits, just like the B-2 out here on the field outside this hangar, or strategic patrols underwater. They are what fuels this success in mission and ensures mission excellence. Intelligence professionals like Lieutenant Mitch St. Clair, though battling a serious medical condition, has continued to give his all in all to support his team. While I'm proud of my team, I would argue that we here at Stratcom cannot have success in addressing the spectrum of conflict without the support from just a host of others. Don't worry, as I do not have enough time to list them all here, but I will salute some of them. All the missions involved, of course, the Office of Secretary of Defense, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and the other combatant commands, every branch of our military service. Also, the interagency, in particular, the White House team, the Department of Energy, especially the National Nuclear Security Administration, and the intelligence community at large. Three-letter organizations like National Reconnaissance Organization, NRO, NGA, NSA, CIA. There is something special about all these three-letter outfits, don't you think? National laboratories, research laboratories, industry, academia, and think tanks, allies and partners. And just what a unique history and support of this great state, Nebraska, and the community it has. Now, Ms. Bonnie and I have thoroughly enjoyed the friendship with some of the most passionate, patriotic, and purposeful people that support mission and our sailors, soldiers, airmen, Marines, and of course our civilians and their families. Our military families get stationed here, and then we have a problem. They don't want to leave. That's because of the genuine support from the community that surrounds us here. So thank you, Congressman Fortenberry, Ashford, Mayor Sanders, and all the local and state political leaders, educational professionals, and businesses that foster the environment and support us so well, and especially the members of the Strategic Command Consultation Committee. Well, Bonnie, thank you for your strength, your love, and support, even when the chips are down. You know how proud and thankful I am of all that you do. Beth, you're sitting here, but we know you have supported us so greatly during this particular tour, and that you represent your brothers so well. Joseph, in college back east, and no, I wouldn't give him a pass to get out of school today, because that's important. Thomas, working with the military at Cherry Point, at the aircraft maintenance center there, but with his wife, Chavise, and our two wonderful grandsons, TJ and Dan. And of course, having the infamous Dr. Yvonne Coates, or shall I say, Sister Yvonne. Thank you for being here representing the broader family, both sides of the family, siblings, Yvette and Penny, and especially our two moms. My mother, Ella Diggs, at the nice young age of 93, and Bonnie's mom, Frida, at the ripe age, young age of 91. Boy, do they have some stories to tell, and they have truly touched us and shaped our lives more than we can ever mention and, of course, are thankful for. And while our mothers could not travel to be here today, we will give them a more detailed rundown, of course, of the activities as we get to spend a little more quality time with them as we move back to Washington, D.C. For both have been so supportive of this tour, just like all the many others. Now, this is my sister Vaughn's first excursion into the state of Nebraska. So I am so glad she could come along with so many other friends, shipmates, classmates, and folks from this wonderful community too, including our church, First Lutheran Church of Omaha. So what a great team and a great team of supporters. Thank you all. Now I could go on and on, but and mention just a number of mentors and shipmates, battle buddies, et cetera, that have all been instrumental to our success during this tour. But in the essence of time, I will not. I got to thank most of you during my recent walk around the command, or the last commander's conference, or during the recent farewell dinner. I think you all know just how appreciative I am of you. So let me change course a little bit here and talk about this change of command. In order to execute one, you need a few things. One, you need your boss. Got that? Your joint military team, represented by most of the folks here in the auditorium in uniform today, except for those that are in so many other places around the globe. And you need a qualified and confirmed relief. So, isn't it grand that John and Laura are here today? Of everyone in this audience, thank you all for coming, but especially John and Laura. You are the most important people here today from my perspective. John and I have been good friends and shipmates, or like they like to say in the Air Force, air wingmen, for the past couple of years. And once he was nominated to be my relief, he not only became my very best friend, but Bonnie's too. While I'm excited, John is relieving me, though, for many, many reasons, many of which have already you've heard from Secretary of Defense Carter and Chairman Joe Dunford. But you know that I think a lot of you, except for one fact, you know, he just is not rooting for the right professional football team. Perhaps the staff can work on that. But he's a talented leader who understands the many missions of U.S. Strategic Command and is truly passionate about leading U.S. Strategic Command and the team of professionals I just described. You have always had my respect, John, and admiration as a visionary leader who gets things done. So I am so very proud of you, and I'm really proud to turn over to someone who I can call a friend. I would predict, after a short spell here, you will all laud John's performance as combatant commander, commander of U.S. Strategic Command, and I will become a legendary has-been. This is exactly the way it's supposed to work, and I will be proud soon to be in that category. So many I have met ever since it was announced that John Hyten was relieving me, they all wanted to know, hey, what are you going to do next? Way too many bring it up as if you're about to die or something, or something incurable like cancer. Others are just a little too happy, as if you've been in place a bit too long. I quickly tell them that Miss Bonnie and I are looking forward to our next chapter in life's journey, and we're excited about it. I look forward to replacing that early morning operation and intelligence brief with a periodic in-depth updates on the grandsons without so much Skype and long-distance communications that we've been using lately. We want more close, literally hands-on shaping operations with those grandsons. No, not just spoiling them, but being able for us to compete as the grandparents of the century. That's what we look forward to. And we look so forward to connecting to more meaningful ways to our families. They have admirably supported us over the years. When I came aboard in November 2013, as was mentioned, I mentioned then I was awestruck in having this opportunity to serve with and to lead at this level. I recalled the great relationships I or we had from our prior tour as deputy commander here, and how I looked forward to continuing them. It is not often one gets to serve as the deputy commander and the commander of the same command. As Bonnie and I steam into the sunset of this assignment in our military career, we know just how blessed we are, especially with these relationships. We respect the fact that life is about opportunities. What a 5-star set of opportunities we've had living here in Nebraska and serving at U.S. Strategic Command as part of an elite joint military team. A chance to lead, cheerlead, and know this extraordinary group of military professionals and their families. A chance to partner with a fantastic group of other combatant commanders and the interagency and international partners. A chance to work on some rather complex and challenging problems. A chance to contribute to strategic stability. A chance to live in a most wonderful community and state. Miss Bonnie and I thank you for making this such a wonderful opportunity. God bless each and every one of you, our joint military forces, and of course, the greatest country on the planet, the United States of America. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing as Admiral Haney's flag will now be hauled down. Ladies and gentlemen, General John Hyten will now join Secretary Carter and Admiral Haney at center stage for the United States Strategic Command Change of Command. Please remain standing. Attention to orders. By direction of the President, Admiral Cecil D. Haney will relinquish command of United States Strategic Command effective 3 November 2016. General John Hyten is directed to assume command of United States Strategic Command effective 3 November 2016. Thank you, Mr. Secretary and Admiral Haney. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, Commander, United States Strategic Command, General John Hyten.
Thank you very much. Hi, Laura. Hi, Katie. Hi, Chris. Secretary Carter, Chairman Mrs. Dumford, Admiral Haney, Bonnie, Congressman Mrs. Ashford, Congressman Fortenberry, Mayor Mr. Sanders, Commanders, Senior Enlisted Leaders, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and most importantly, the soldiers, sailors, airmen, marine, the men and women of the U.S. Strategic Command, good morning. It is truly an honor to be here. I can't help but notice how life sometimes seems to come full circle, sometimes when you least expect it. 20 years ago, Laura and I packed up our family and moved from Colorado Springs to Omaha to take command of the 6th Base Operations Squadron here at Offutt. I honestly felt that would be the only time I'd be given the opportunity to command in my career, and it was a special time, both in my career and our lives. We loved that squadron. We were so impressed with how the local community reached out and took care of us. We had a group of incredible airmen and families, and we together accomplished some amazing things. And now, once again, here we are. We just packed up, just Laura and me this time, because Katie and Chris have moved out. They're on their own doing great things. But Laura and I packed up and moved again from Colorado Springs to Nebraska to take command once again, but this time of a slightly larger, slightly more complex organization, the United States Strategic Command. But it's great to be back here at Offutt. It is a special community with great people. So the circle's complete, and we are excited to be here. I first need to thank President Obama, Secretary Carter, General Dunford for their confidence in me and for nominating me for this job. I also need to thank the Senate for confirming me into this position. I will point out that the selection process for this position was slightly more complicated than my selection process to command here 20 years ago. That's probably another slight indication that the job I'm going into may be a little more difficult. But I also need to thank a truly amazing officer and a leader, my operational commander until last Tuesday, Admiral Cecil Haney and his wife Bonnie. Admiral Haney led with a unique grace and humility that was a remarkable example to all of us who had the good fortune to call him boss. He embraced the challenges of Stratcom's many diverse missions and moved us forward into the right direction together. Thank you, sir, for all you've done, and thank you, Bonnie, for being a great partner to a great leader. I am truly honored to stand here today in front of all of you and take command of U.S. Strategic Command. It's actually a bit overwhelming in some ways, particularly when you look at those who came before me. When I look at the portraits on the walls as I walk into the command section, I see some of the greatest leaders in the history of our country. There's no way I belong in that group. The legacy of this command starts with Strategic Air Command, SAC, and that means George Kenney, Curtis LeMay, and other amazing legends. In recent years, the leaders at Stratcom have been heroes and mentors of mine. Most recently, that meant Chilton, Kaler, and Haney. But there were many other heroes of mine before that. It's a bit intimidating, honestly, but it's also exciting. I know I am not their equal, not even close, but I am motivated to try to live up to their legacy, and so to each and every one of the amazing joint warriors of this command, to the soldiers, sailors, airmen, and marine of U.S. Strategic Command, from all across our nation, and to our allies who stand with us against the most dangerous threats on the planet, I pledge my best efforts to support you each and every day I'm lucky enough to be allowed to command this incredible organization. The Cold War is over. We won. SAC was one of the primary reasons why. However, the world is once again a very dangerous place, and those dangers seem to be building daily. We have a myriad of threats now that we must worry about. Nuclear threats, to be sure, but also threats in space, in cyberspace, and in many other areas where Stratcom plays a leading role. During the Cold War, the SAC motto was simple and to the point. Peace is our profession. I like that motto, because it expressed in four simple words what SAC was all about. It meant that in order to keep the peace, we had to be ready and willing to fight the most unthinkable war at a moment's notice. And although the world has changed and the Cold War is history, I would offer to you that that motto is still true for this command today. We never want to go to war with nuclear weapons. We never want to go to war in space or cyberspace either. War that extends into these domains is bad for our country, bad for our allies, bad for the world, but in order to keep the peace, we must be ready and willing to fight these kinds of wars if called upon. And thanks to Admiral Haney and the leaders past, we have always been ready, and we will be ready in the future, ready for any global conflict that extends into any domain. That's because peace is our profession. And now, for the Men and Women Strategic Command, this might seem a little bit strange to you, but I'm going to share with you my two red lines, things I don't like and things I will not tolerate. I have shared these in every change of command speech I've given during my career, including the speech I gave to my first squadron here at Offutt Air Force Base in 1996, so I'm not going to stop now. Some may disagree, but I think I'm actually pretty easy to get along with unless you cross one of these lines. First, I can handle any news that comes through my door except old news. If something good happens, let me know and I'll celebrate it with you. If something bad happens, let me know and I'll help you fix it. But if something happens and you choose not to tell me when I find out, and I will, I'm not going to worry about you. I'm just going to worry about fixing that problem. I will not worry about you at all. Second, everybody that chooses to come to work in this command, everybody that comes to work in U.S. Strategic Command, each and every one of you has made a special commitment to this nation, and you deserve to be treated with respect. I have no patience for those who don't treat others with respect that they have earned, and I don't think those people have any place in this business. I don't want them even around, period. It's funny how quiet it gets whenever I finish those two things. But I tell you, even with those red lines, I really feel like I'm easy to understand. I look forward to working with each and every one of you every day. I look forward to the future of this command, building on the tremendous legacy of those who came before us. And finally, let me take a minute to properly acknowledge my family and friends. I really appreciate Mr. Secretary, Mr. Chairman, Admiral Haney, everybody mentioned in my family, because they really are the reason I'm here. It's remarkable the things that they have done to me. So if you want to know what I think, who I am, some people say I'm a very determined person, dogged determination. Some people say I have an over-focus on the mission. Some people say I just focus on love and family because they are the most important things to me. Some people say that I really just care about each and every one of you all the time. All of that is true, but all of that I learned from my family over the years. If you want to know how that came into place, all you have to do is look at the last 24 hours. Because in the last 24 hours, it was tough around here. My mom and dad are here from Alabama. Laura's mom is here from California. Let's just say they've achieved an age we all aspire to. They're really old. But interestingly enough, look over that. They're all here. Every one of them. Most of them weren't here at midnight last night because a bunch of them came through Chicago. Chicago was not good yesterday. Except if you're a Cubs fan, but the airport was not good. Our daughter, Katie, Southwest Airlines was kind enough to drop her in the middle of Midway at midnight last night with no plans, no hotel room, and no way to get here this morning. But through her brother Chris and the help of a lot of other people, she got in a cab, probably a Uber, went across town, got to O'Hare, got a hotel, got up this morning, bought a ticket on American Airlines, landed at 8:52 this morning and was here by 10 o'clock. That's awesome. My mom and dad took off yesterday morning. Like I said, they're old. They took off yesterday morning from Huntsville, Alabama. They got to Chicago probably around 1 o'clock. They left Chicago last night a little after 11. Sitting in the airport, Mom, I can't even imagine what you went through. Holy cow. But guess what? They got here. Laura's family, Laura's mom, Marilyn, they got in here late last night at midnight. And then if you think about the entire family showing up after midnight, what does that mean? That means we got a whole lot of cars going back and forth to the airport at midnight. And guess what? I wasn't in one of those cars because Laura wouldn't let me get in the car. And if Laura tells you not to get in the car, don't get in the car. It's really that simple. But holy cow, they're the ones that have dogged determination. They're the ones that will not fail. You tell them to do something, they're gonna do. Dad, it's okay if you don't come this time. It's all right. Marilyn, it's okay if you don't come this time. I'm coming. Just get out of the way. Tell me how to get there. I'm gonna make it here. And every one of them made it here. So thank you all for being there for me all the time. I love you more than you know. I have many other friends here and I don't have time to acknowledge them all, but I hope to talk to each of you later today and thank you for coming. But a couple of warnings, especially the folks on this side of the room and the folks in formation. Ed Seward's here as well as Jim and Libby McEwen. They were my bosses when I was a second lieutenant. Yeah, you have stories. Lisa Alexander's here from Arkansas. She's probably my family's oldest friends. She also has stories. So my warning, don't believe what they say. They all exaggerate. They all exaggerate a lot. And just to be clear, that applies to every one of my family as well. Do not believe the stories they tell on me. Many others are also here from the local area, from Nebraska, from Iowa, family from Iowa. Some came out from Colorado, from all over the country. It's great to see so many friendly faces. Thank you. And then right down in front, the best of who I am, my wife, Laura, and our two children, Katie and Chris. The kids are awesome. Katie came in from Boston, supposed to go through Chicago, stopped in Indianapolis just for grins, I guess. Flew into Indianapolis, came down here, working for a great nonprofit called the Essential Partners, doing awesome things in Boston. Our son Chris flew in from Denver, a golf professional living in Castle Pines, Colorado. His life is not bad. If you get a chance to talk to them, you'll find out just how amazing they are. They are truly remarkable. I love you two very much. And last but not least, my beautiful wife, Laura. Offutt, Omaha, Bellevue, they're lucky to have you back. For many years, she's worked tirelessly to support our nation's airmen and their families. Now she gets to expand that passion to supporting our soldiers, sailors, and Marines as well. She will be active in this community. She will be active in this command because that's just who she is. She can't stop. But she's also my best friend, my biggest supporter, and as everyone knows, she loves me a lot despite my shortcomings. And there are many of those. But everybody here should also know that I love her more. Don't forget that. So thank you for being here today. God bless the men and women of this command. God bless the men and women who are fighting overseas today, and God bless the United States of America. It's time to get to work.
Thank you, General Hyten. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for a medley of service songs. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain in place for the departure of the official party and the retirement of colors.